Hi, my name is Gillian, and welcome to this video lectures on the concepts of stress and strain. We know from physics that for a spring, a linear relationship exists between the load applied and the extension of the spring. We also know that the slope of such a diagram is linear and is equal to the spring stiffness k. Looking at it differently, one could view the spring stiffness as the resistance of the spring against loading. So, rather than just looking at springs, let's see what we can say about the resistance against loading for materials in general. Let us therefore have a look at these two foam dies. On the left, we have one die, and on the right, we have two. What would happen if we compress both with the same weight? As you can see, that in the case of two dies, double the diameter of one die, the deformation is less than if the same weight is applied to the single die. Their combined resistance against deformation is higher. So, if like the spring, we were to plot the load against the elongation of a beam, we will observe that analog to a spring, a linear relationship between the load and elongation exists. Here, we can also observe the existence of a resistance against loading. Just like I have shown you just now, if you have a beam with a much larger diameter and we were to plot this in a diagram, we can see that the resistance against deformation increases. It becomes more difficult to deform the cylinder. This brings us to the question why. Now, although we engineers like making predictions, we do not actually use a crystal ball to make them. Instead, we use observations, and from these observations, we try to find explanations from the world of physics and math for what we see, and if necessary, find solutions for the problems at hand. So, let us now take another look at structures under a load. Is there a way we can relate similar cases? In this example, there is a beam with an oblong cross-section of length L and width T, loaded by a constant force F as depicted in picture A. For this beam, we can plot a force elongation diagram as shown by line A, and in the same diagram, we have also plotted the diagram of a beam that is twice as thick, as shown in picture B. We see that the slope of this diagram is twice that of diagram A. If we also plot the force elongation diagram for the third beam, C, which is twice as long as beam A, we see that the curve is stretched twice as much. As all beams are made of the same material, we'd really like to be able to look at the material's response to a load in a way that is not dependent on the dimensions of the structure. We really need to find a way to eliminate geometry. The question is, how do we do that? This is why we will introduce the concepts of stress and strain. These two concepts will be defined irrespective of the dimensions of the object that is subjected to a load. Let us take a look at a rectangular beam of length L that is pulled apart by a force F. As a result of the applications of this force to the beam will become longer by a distance delta L, the triangle depicting the Greek capital letter delta. We can now define strain, denoted by the lowercase Greek letter epsilon, as the elongation delta L divided by the initial length of the beam L. Strain is often expressed as a percentage by multiplying the outcome of this formula by 100. We now replace the elongation from our force elongation diagram with strain, which is no longer a function of length, instead just the ratio of deformation. Similarly, we can now define stress as the force F divided by the cross-sectional area A on which it acts. Stress is denoted by the lowercase Greek letter sigma. In our load elongation diagram, we now replace the load with the stress sigma. By doing this, we have now completely eliminated the geometry of the object, and we are now solely looking at material characteristics. Let us take a closer look at this stress-strain diagram. If you look at the first part, from the origin in O to point A, we can recognize the linear relationship we found earlier in our load elongation diagrams. This represents, similar to springs, the reversible behavior of a material. This is referred to as linear elastic behavior, which means that if the load is removed, the material will return to its original shape. Next in the diagram, you can observe a point B, which has been named sigma 0.2, or yield stress. At this location, 0.2% offset of the linear elastic slope, from which point on, plastic, irreversible deformation takes place. As it is difficult to exactly determine the transition from elastic to plastic behavior, known as yielding, this is a practical solution, and safe lower limit used to define when this behavior starts to occur. All stress exceeding the yield stress now causes plastic permanent deformation. If we continue along the graph, you can see that we reach a maximum stress level in point D. This point is known as ultimate stress, and the maximal stress a material can withstand that is denoted as sigma ultimate. This does not mean, however, that the material breaks a 2 into this point. That also depends on other properties. As you can see, the material continues to bear stresses, only at a lower stress level, and the material continues to deform. It eventually breaks at point E. If you've ever pulled something apart, such as a strip of flexible candy or gum, you will have probably observed that the strip gets thinner first, before failing completely. This behavior can be seen in more materials, such as metals for instance, and this phenomenon is called necking. If you think about this, you may say that we should no longer divide the load by its original area, but rather by its actual area at the time. This is why in engineering we've defined two types of stresses. Engineering stress, which is defined as the force F divided by its nominal or original area, and true stress, which is defined as the load F divided by the true area A. The consequence of this is that if you were to plot the true stress instead of the engineering stress in a stress strain curve, the true stress will continue to increase until failure is reached. However, it is very difficult to determine the actual cross-section during testing. So for practical reasons, the engineering stress is used in stress analysis, which is a safe underestimate of the maximum stress a material can withstand.